full screen. So I will start with the gentleman that has his picture closest to me, because that's Stefan. He's quite close to Valerie in Vienna, but he's a bit further away from the topic in the sense that he knows all about interoperability, but in another sector. Because when Valerie started to work on this topic, she told me quite early on, you know, we should look at e-health in a bit more detail because they're really advanced and we can learn something from there. And that's why Stefan is here, because he knows all about e-health. Then who else has right recent experience in interoperability is Olivier. So really great to have Olivier from NSUI here. It is currently not necessarily an experience on consumer data, but all kind of other network related data where in the context of network codes, NSUI had to step up and handle a lot of interoperability issues. Then also I'm very happy to have Jeremy here from across the Atlantic from an initiative called the Green Button Initiative, which has a really cool name, by the way, and a nice logo. And he will tell us more because he's bringing us already closer to consumer data, which is really the challenge in front of us. And then Luis. Luis is here because he has to handle the new challenge. He's very close to consumer data. He's not only EDP, but he's also very active in European research projects like Interface, where we are expected to deal with interoperability and where our own research actually originates from. And that leads me to introduce Valerie. Valerie is now for Florence School of Regulation leading this research, and she's very active in the Interface project. And she will present us the policy brief we drafted. And we give you here the last chance to give comments on that brief. It's, you know, speak now or keep silent, because we will finalize the policy brief immediately after this event and publish it. Please, Valerie, the next 10 minutes is yours to give us the presentation. Unmute, Valerie.
Can you
yes,
hear me now?
Now we can
yes,
hear you.
Always the technical issues at the beginning. Thank you, Leo. Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining our online event. I'll be introducing the topic a bit. So some of you might have asked yourselves upfront why we even talk about interoperability, or why we think why there is a need to make even an online event about interoperability. And we've also heard quite some often IT, ICT experts say, well, this is a very technical topic, you know, and it's nothing new, actually. And this is somewhat true. But then on the other hand, there are also dimensions that go beyond the technical issues of interoperability. And the topic has got recently a lot of attention because it's very high on the European agenda. And actually, the Commission at the latest Florence Forum of 2019 defined it as one of the legislative priorities in energy. So this is why we talk about it. And then there is also a bit of an interesting history to why interoperability. And this is when we go back in time, around 3 years, to the beginning of the discussions around the Clean Energy Package and the Electricity Directive. Then we can see that at that point, we were still talking about a common European data format. And this, in the process, got somehow removed. And now, with the final version of the Electricity Directive and the Clean Energy Package, you see at the right hand of the slide that the European Commission is entitled to adopt interoperability requirements and procedures for access to data. And which data? Well, it's about customer or consumer data. So the article defines it very specifically. It says metering and consumption data, as well as data for customer switching, demand response, and other services. And what you can also see is that the member states are required to facilitate the full interoperability of energy services. And it's very interesting that there are no definitions given. So neither full interoperability nor interoperability requirements are defined. And this is why we started to think about the topic, and why also one of the factors why we wrote this policy document. And today we want to discuss mainly two things. The first point that I want to raise is that we think that in the debate, we should take account of the multiple dimensions that interoperability has. And what do we mean by that? Well, in general, you could say that there are two broad perspectives of interoperability if you want. There is a narrow one that relates more to the ICT perspective, so really the interoperability between ICT systems. And then there is a broader perspective, which says, or which relates more to the ability of organizations to work together more effectively and more efficiently. Also, but not only, via the interoperability of their ICT systems. And we think that is the second that should probably be adopted in this discussion. Now, what you see on the slide are so-called interoperability frameworks. And you can see that we don't have the time to go through all of them in detail. That's not the point. But these frameworks, they kind of describe a set of common elements that describe the way in which organizations agree to interact with each other and to exchange data. And they span across sectors. So you see we have something from the electricity sector, also something from public services, and there's one for e-health. And what you see when you look at this slide at first sight, you see that there are different numbers of layers and that these layers are called differently. And also that some of them, they relate to each other. So one of the things that they all have in common is that they all say in order to reach interoperability, we need to get all stakeholders involved and an agreement on all the layers of concern needs to be reached. And then there are also other commonalities that we identified in our research. And we think that they can be indicative for what we should be discussing in Europe when we talk about the interoperability of energy services. I'll be very brief. So one is that there needs to be regulatory and policy alignment on the different geographical levels. Then responsibilities should be allocated to harmonized roles and not to specific parties that are specific to a certain national context, for example, or to a specific implementation. Then organizations or actors that have agreed to work with each other, exchange data, they're very likely to have different languages, of different processes that all need to be aligned. This is what we mean when we say business processes via the use also of agreed modeling techniques. And then you also need processes and methodologies that make sure that the format and the meaning of the data and the information that is exchanged is preserved and understood throughout the whole process. These frameworks usually also take account of the fact that standards are necessary, but they also say that standards is not enough. So the use of standards is not enough, and that at a certain point, interoperability testing and maybe also certification is needed. And then I already mentioned the stakeholder involvement. So these are points that we think could be indicative for the discussion we are having in Europe. Then a second point relates to previous experience. And here we kind of have the hypothesis that when we talk about interoperability, we don't need to reinvent the wheel, or at least not fully. We can also relate to experiences that already exist with interoperability. And I will go through them very briefly. So the first that we have, and for all of them, we would like to specifically ask the question if different experiences can also inspire different solutions. So it might be that one of these initiatives inspires a different set of use cases than the other. So this is the overall question that we would like to pose. And very briefly to go through them, one is the North American Green Button Initiative that you can see on the slide. And it's really an industry-led effort to provide utility customers with easy and secure access to their energy usage information via the green button. So what do they do? Very simply, you see this green button on the top right corner of the slide. The utilities that support it in the US, they have this green button on their website. You can click on it, you can download your data, and you can give consent to share it. Those are the two use cases. And interesting, there is a green button standard that has been developed that involves some things that are mentioned on the slide, like a common XML format or a data exchange protocol. And they also work with existing utility systems via the application of an API or via the use of an API. So here for Green Button, we would generally like to ask the question if this could serve as a sort of inspiration for emerging use cases in Europe that deal with sharing data. So really downloading and sharing your energy usage information. Then next up is N2E. N2E, as Leo already said, has gained experience with interoperability in the implementation of data exchange requirements that come from the electricity network codes, but also, for example, from the transparency platform or from the 10-year network development plan. And they follow a very specific and elaborate comprehensive process that you can see on the slide. I will not go into detail, but one of the main pillars of the N2E approach is that they try to define a common language. So really terms and terminologies that are used so that all the stakeholders involved share a common understanding of what is talked about. This is basically the basis And then they enter into this process and it covers the specification of requirements. It covers the use of SCAM and other modeling technologies or techniques. It covers the identification of standardization gaps and the aim to fill these gaps. And it ends with interoperability testing and also sometimes at least with the publication of standards that are sometimes also very specific to the needs of European TSOs. And here we would like to ask the question whether this approach can kind of serve as an inspiration for existing retail services that have been implemented in the member states for a very long time, and where we understand that there is a need for a generic framework that is generic enough, but that can also host different implementations that already exist in the member states. And then the last one, and a bit out of the box, is healthcare, because in healthcare, the interoperability journey has started a long time ago, I think more than 20 years ago, with the exchange of X-ray images, I think across hospitals. And now, as you can see on the slide on the left-hand side, the sector reached a point where they are actually discussing a European electronic health record exchange format. So another element that is interesting for healthcare is that the industry has developed a very comprehensive methodology to reach and maintain interoperability. And one of the very unique elements of healthcare are these testing events that you can see on the right-hand side of the slide. For some, they're called Connectathon, but it's just an example. There are also other testing events. And here for healthcare, we would like to ask the general question, whether this can serve as inspiration for energy. Maybe we can use some of these approaches or methodologies that have been used, or maybe we can also learn from the governance of the healthcare interoperability initiatives. So this was to very briefly introduce the experience, and now I hand over to Leo.
Thank you, Valerie. So I think a perfect introduction to the initiatives we have here, but it's also great to have the actual experts. So I think we can start again in the same order. So Stefan, you're out of the box for us, but normally. So what do you think about, can you please elaborate a bit on that e-health experience?
Yes, the e-health experience was driven by the main stakeholders in big companies, big hospitals, and they, in the 20 years ago, as Valerie said, they built X-ray departments, radiology departments, and you had to link two process worlds, the administration, the patient identity, the names and the dates, and then the imaging domain. And we had two different spheres of standards, and they had to be interlinked. And that didn't work out completely. And both standards are very big and complex, and there are dialects. And so the projects failed miserably. And at some point, the companies noticed that this doesn't work out. So we form IHE, Integrating the Healthcare Enterprise. And we are starting a use case-based approach to define the requirements, the data sharing requirements, and then to come up with specifications, interoperability profiles, and also with a testing procedure. And then that really did the trick of making projects very easy and increasing the reliability and reducing the effort to get things going very dramatically. And you've seen the image. We have yearly test events on multiple sites on the planet now. So this is very evolved and really a great source. And there are a lot of, as a community, so this has really worked out fine. And there are many things in common between healthcare and energy. You are as well in energy, you are relying on security, on safety, and there are timing issues. There's a strong relation to regulatory issues, and you're also involving professional communication, and you're now going to the step to also involve the customer, like business to consumer. And the similar story is on in healthcare. So we are happy to learn from you as well. And the one experience I can share is that, especially if you go to the consumer world, it opens up a complete new box, because you cannot update software in an end consumer device very easily. And that is the similar thing. So you start to update at the server, blah, blah, blah. And I'm looking forward to hear your detailed discussions, and then we can go deeper in some details.
Before I hand over to the others to make an opening statement, I would still like to know a bit more. It was really an industry-led initiative, or have there been some push from European institutions? Because in energy, we're quite used to, to have industry initiatives after a gentle push.
No, it was clearly driven by the vendors together with the customers, and that is very important. Because if a project fails, then you have a big trouble at the customer end as well as at the vendor end. And so these together, they said, we are failing in so many different geographies and sites and for many different reasons. So we want to get this settled. Mm. So far, you have seen Valerie showing the European patient record format. Politics is only very slowly learning what happens here. And we still don't have a uniform procedure which gives us a timeline for ramping this up. This is now evolving on some very, very small islands, but there is still no European or global timeline where this is going to be rolled out end to end. And this is still evolving. And that is something we might want to discuss.
Very interesting, very interesting. Probably, I think I would first go to Olivier, right? And because then we get closer and closer to the topic of consumer data in energy. Olivier, so please, your initiative.
So hello, everybody. Hello, Leonardo. So I think we are still in ENSOE close to the consumer data in the sense that in many member states, we see that there is a consumer data hub that is being set up. And in many cases, the TSO is set as the responsible of the data hub. So it's not always the case. It's not in all the member states. And here we can say that we can differentiate the role of the data hub responsible and the actor, which can be the DSO or the TSO or something joint between TSO and DSO or others. And that makes the link a little bit to the approach that we have here in ENSOE is, I really liked what you said, Stéphane, when you said that you are based on the use cases. And I think it's very important to first clearly define the use case that we are going to tackle. And it's really the first mistake that we can make is to go directly into the data format without looking at what are we talking about, what is the use case. And in ENSOE, that is what we do, is that we first define the use case, so the use case, and we use a role model for that, so a harmonized role model that we have in common with ENSOE, EFET, and EBIX. And based on that, we can define some interactions between the different roles, and we define what we call a sequence diagram, and that define all the exchange between the different roles. And only when we have those sequence diagram, we can define the common language that Valérie was referring to, which we believe is very, very important. So if we don't have a common language, it's not possible to interact, to have interoperability between systems. We have many use cases in the TSO community that involve different domains, for example, the market and the system of operation. And we also face this kind of mapping where we have to put two words together to be able to talk together. And here, I would say with the retail market, my message would be that it is important to also keep the link between, in terms of semantic, between what we are exchanging in the wholesale market and in the retail market, because we have a lot of exchanges between the distributor, the transmission system operator, and the market participant. And it's very important that one information that is given to the consumer has a meaning that is kept in the whole European electricity market sector between all the actors. So that's a key point. For us.
Yeah, and as a additional question, to what extent do you think that your approach was conditioned or made possible by the fact that it still involves a limited number of parties? So if we go to use cases that involve many more parties, would we still be able to follow your approach, or where would your approach reach its limits? potentially? Yeah.
So here we need to differentiate the different parts of our approach. So when we talk about the role model, the sequence diagram, this is really something that can be done exactly in the same way when we talk about having a common information model, meaning an ontology, a dictionary for the use case. It's really something that can be a copy and paste in terms of approach. What we do in N3 is that we are defining profiles. So we are really going into the details of the data exchange to that agreement, let's say, between the parties. And here we really need to have a smart approach by defining profiles that are flexible enough so that the different member states can, have a common frame, but still can have the flexibility to add some information that is on top of it for, I don't know, for Belgium because they are more complex than everybody else, or for Germany because they like to exchange this data on top of it. So it needs to have something that is strict enough so that we understand each other, but flexible enough so that we can still add a few data here and there. And this is correct for the information, for the semantic, and also for the process. So we need to have a core process that everyone has to follow, but we need to keep the flexibility to have, I don't know, for example, in the capacity calculation, that is one of our process in N3, we have several regions in Europe, and the region are having sometimes a few additional data exchange that they need because of some specificities. But it doesn't compromise the full process. It's an option that the member state can add. And this is very important. We need to have this for the consumer data. We need to have this core process, core information model, and the flexibility to add some specificities at member state level.
Thank you, Olivier.
Maybe Leonardo, one more thing is, yes. When we talk about standardization, I think it's very important to have standardization in this consumer data. However, we need to be careful not to put the fear to the people that they have to change their IT system from now to tomorrow. It's the standardization. It is in the long run. It's very important to define a target that can evolve also during the time. But it doesn't mean, I think we should avoid to put in the regulation by tomorrow morning, please update all your system to this new standard. We need to have a target standard, and then the industry will evolve little by little to go towards, to go to this target.
Okay. Yeah, and we'll come back to that specific point in the second part of our discussion. Okay. Like, where do you start? How do you reach where you want to go? But still, please, Jeremy, tell us a bit more about your initiative.
Absolutely. Thank you for having us be a part of this. We've experienced quite a bit in North America, and we have the advantage, of course, of having provinces in Canada that intercommunicate as one country, as well as in the States, even though things operate as separate entities in those different regions. It's kind of a unique situation that we're in, and we'd love to share that with you. So I think it's important to look back at how things came about, because that lends itself to the discussion that we'll have as we go forward. In the early stages, the American National Institute of Standards and Technology had created a smart grid interoperability panel of energy domain experts. And this was really to solve interdependency and interoperability issues in the U.S. electrical grid. So if you remember from hearing in the news at the time, many areas of our country were experiencing increases in electricity consumption, but with aging and outdated infrastructure. Mm. So this resulted in a lot of blackouts. And some of those blackouts were wide ranging and stretching across regions. And so there was an effort on that part of it that was moving forward. Then in parallel, at the same time, the federal government in the US was looking at ways to make the data they collected available to the public. And this was to promote innovation and increase transparency. And so to do all of that, there was a plan to increase this public-private handover of the resulting efforts. And of the efforts started in the federal government specifically to the private sector and to the nonprofits, so essentially giving back the tax dollars, if you will. So there was an effort initially called the Blue Button, and you saw a logo on this on the slides a moment ago. The Blue Button was an effort of the Veterans Administration here in the United States, and it was a program that allowed military personnel to download their medical information and take it to civilian doctors. It since that point grew to be able to allow you to go from one health insurance provider to another and share that medical information back and forth. So it's very much like what Stefan is doing and the projects that they're working on. That led Anish Chopra, the first chief technology officer of the United States, to suggest that we should do a similar type of thing for the energy industry. Something that would allow energy usage data to be downloaded in that same way. And he proposed to expand the downloading button theme, if you will, to this energy side of things and call it the green button. And so that was where you get the term green button off of blue button initially. So the industry experts that were part of this smart grid panel took some of the standards that they were creating and combined them into what ultimately became today's North American Energy Standards Board Energy Services Provider Interface, or more easily said, the green button. And so that was all back in about 2011, culminating in 2012. And then there was a need, and I think we're going to talk about some of these things as we move forward, a need for there to be a central place for all of these efforts to provide that interoperability, to provide that testing and so forth. And so the Green Button Alliance was formed as a nonprofit organization at the start of 2015. So that's where we are today. This all, as you can see, culminated with this White House call to action. But there was a similar action happening at the same time with the Ontario Ministry of Energy in Canada. So it was a great opportunity to tackle all of North America.
And your initiative is remaining that one specific use case, or do you think the same approach can be applied to other use cases also?
Yeah, it's interesting. Well, we have multiple use cases that go into all of this sort of a thing. And the initial downloading of data has actually now become a connection of data as well. So there's two basic formats of or methods of getting the data from one place to another. But it can indeed, it can be shared more widely. The idea behind Green Button and being just focused on this narrow topic was to focus on that one problem and to solve it well. Mm-hmm. And so that's one of those things where you can have standards that cover everything, or you can have standards that are very narrow and focused on what they're supposed to do. That being said, the model can be used for nearly any data sharing where the customer is at the center. And that's the idea. They're at the center of authorizing, revoking, and directing all of the sharing that they're doing. So I think it can be used for many other things. Today, it carries electricity, natural gas, water data, cost information, temperature. But you could have additional information as well. You could have full weather information, for example. You could expand that model or duplicate it, if you will, to carry other things.
Thank you, Jeremy.
Sure.
So, Luis, your role here is to tell us how much of this experience you think can be applied to the new challenges in front of us. Even though that it's not all on you, as Olivier said, he's ready to help you. In some countries, TSOs take a very active role on these new challenges of consumer data. Mm-hmm. But from what you heard so far, what's your takeaway?
Thank you. Thank you. First of all, thank you, Leonardo. Thank you, Valerie, for inviting us to join this discussion, a very interesting one. So I must start by saying that we can learn and we will learn from everyone. But we must say also that we learn from our experience from the past. As you know, we have been dealing with data from consumer side for the last 20 years, at least, starting by the commercial industrial customers, then the small and medium enterprises. And nowadays we are sharing also data from low voltage customers, household customers. So we have quite an experience from that side. What we see, there are a few points that I would like to raise here in our discussion. First of all, I think we need to to understand that the need for data is not a single directional need. It's not only the consumer or the market parties that need the data from the DSO side or the TSO or whomever is going to provide the data. It's also the system operators that need the data from their context, from their environment, in order to operate in an efficient way, in a cost-effective way, the networks. As you know, we live in a very much more challenging environment right now because of the renewals on one side, on the other side, the dynamics of the consumer demand, I would say, consumer, prosumer slash energy communities. So it's becoming very much more complex. So we need to gather, we need to think in another way. We need to implement a culture of sharing of data. So we need to share data with everyone, and everyone needs to share data with us. That is main principle. Having said this, I think we also need to keep it simple. And we need to, and when speaking about sharing data, we are not addressing specifically the energy sector. It's something that comes from all sectors. It's something that is central to the digitalization process. So data sharing is not something new. There are a lot of people like the ones that you invited today that know a lot of this, have implemented a lot of initiatives and can share with the others. But there are also a lot of works that the European Commission has been doing the last years. I can just say a few. I recently saw a paper from Joint Research Center that clearly specifies what needs to be done in terms of interoperability for sharing government data, which is a very important step forward. But then let me also make here a statement just to raise some discussion, if you don't mind. I think we need to avoid some discussions during the discussion of interoperability topics. One is mixing up the discussion with the use of the data hubs concepts or the centralized versus centralized discussion. I think standardization and interoperability has nothing to do with central data hubs or decentralized data hubs or standards to a certain extent, but not to this concept of centralized versus decentralized. So we should avoid discuss these models because there are different models across Europe. There are different realities. And one thing that interoperability will allow us to do is to work with different standards and with different governance models. And that is the key beauty of interoperability, allow us to do a lot of things. Having said this, of course, this is not simple. And we need to learn from the ones that already implemented that. And I don't know, it was Jeremy that mentioned that in the United States, they're starting by demanding interoperability for smart grids. And when you think about smart grids, you see that smart grids interoperability is much more complex than sharing data, because you need to take into account the devices, the assets, and everything from the hardware level to the semantic level. So it's a different environment. When we move towards an environment where we only want to share services, and then the remaining part, the interoperability for acting on behalf of those services and interacting with consumers is part of the already existing applications or the new ones that are coming from the startups or the entrepreneurs, I think it's we have our work in such a way simplified, I would say. So what we need to discuss is how to integrate the existing options, the existing standards, and we need, of course, to start by defining the use cases. I know you have mentioned the interface project. We are part of the project. That project started 2 years ago, 2018, which is a very interesting project. The reason why we are there is also because it is interesting. We would like to cooperate and give our contribution. But we also have started very recently another project, which is called Universal. That is exactly about interoperability. The main goal of this project is to launch foundations for universal interoperable applications on the domain, in the specific domain of flexibility services and data sharing. So I think we need to take into account all these initiatives, and somehow during our discussion, I think we will touch upon the governance models that you have also touched in your paper, and we can have I can also say a few words on that.
Thank you, Luis. Before we enter into that, let me just ask if anyone wants to react to what has already been said, and also remind all participants that they can also react with clarification questions or any other issue they want to raise in the chat box or in this Q&A box. don't hesitate to do that. But we have more than enough to continue talking among us also. Does anyone want to react to anything that has been said? Or do you even have a question for each other? Yeah, Stefan, please.
Yeah, one thing that strikes me, if you're talking about governance, I'm today we are all looking at the corona COVID infections. And what we see is a daily update of the case numbers across Europe and across the world, actually. And now looking at this data, you then are measuring your measures, the decisions you took 2 weeks ago to lower the social distance. And then you will see an effect. And I think that is something that unites the energy problem to the healthcare problem. You establish some kind of measurement and then you try to improve it. And if you do that, and that's what you clearly learn from energy, there you must have a global unique data model and codes in order to be able to compare that data. And that is where the localization ends. And if you want to do this, there must be a global governance, at least on this simple goal. You may have regional differences later down the line, but that is something I think probably you might want to do in energy as well. That's what I like to learn.
Somebody wants to react to that? Not immediately. Okay, let me ask you. So just to the people that just are at the end of a process, right? So you have Jeremy, you have Stefan, Olivier, that really can look back and say, okay, this thing you've implemented and you achieved interoperability for certain use cases in certain areas. How did you get there? Did you know from the beginning what you were doing, or is it more you start and you learn along the way and you work with it? So how planned has the process been from, was it so easy to set the target and then to live up to it, or how has it been? How, the road to success, Jeremy.
Yeah, thanks. The road to success is a bumpy one. We actually came out with the green button and then had to go to a sort of a new version, if you will. Obviously, the core of it remained the same, the whole idea of the exchanging the data and so forth. But a lot of things have changed. Security was a big differentiator. Fortunately, there was a lot of thought that went into the development of this to simplify it in terms of the formats, but also in terms of the standards. We didn't want to invent all the standards. We wanted to take things that were out there and utilize them. And so one of the things that changed was the authorization mechanism. Initially, we used OAuth 1.0. We now use OAuth 2.0. And because of the fact that we use something that isn't core to the data format, we are able to be more flexible as we increase the abilities of the protocol to stay in tune with things like security changes. So that altered the way we did some of the communications between third-party companies who build applications to help consumers and the utilities and their interfaces. So the way you authorize things now is a bit different. We also kept certain things out intentionally, authentication of a customer for a utility, for example. We've left this portion to the utility so that the utility has the ability to add things if they wish, two-factor authentication or ways to use the cell phone or ways to use an authenticator application or an RSA tag, whatever they want to do to ensure that their customer is the one doing the authorization. That becomes up to them. And so we don't ask the utilities to change the processes that they're using today, but instead we tack this on, and the data streams that come to the green button platform, if you will, can be entirely separated from the way they store their data or the conceptual design of their data. So again, by leaving these things out and by specifically focusing on what we do, we are able to prevent those types of problems where we have to take that bumpy road of modifications. We can focus on the data format, and we can focus on making sure that we choose the proper standards to ensure the data transfer.
Thank you, Jeremy. So, Stefan, mm-hmm. how bumpy was your road?
Well, yeah, it was horribly bumpy. If you're just looking at the scope of the problem, yeah, like you're dating, just like Jeremy mentioned, you're discussing the content, you're discussing the transfer protocols, you're discussing logistics, laws, and you're going down to the security level and to TCP/IP and blah, blah, blah. It's a huge problem. And going into testing and profile development and then into deployment, and there is so much you have to do. And one wisdom we got out of our cooperation with Valerie and her colleagues in Vienna on the smart grid was that we thought about how should we start this work and what should be the size of the problem that we wish to tackle within the next year. And within the healthcare domain, a yearly cycle has evolved where you can be sure you throw in a problem, the problem gets analyzed, and then you come up with one project, two projects, a reasonable number of projects of a reasonable size. And we developed some kind of numerics to judge the reasonable size, being the number of software components that you have in a specific interoperability use case, and the number of transactions you can handle. And on the other side, how large is the group that tackles this problem? Do you have a sufficient number of representative users from different regions who have a similar problem? Are the vendors involved? Is there some business need to actually get this going? Is there a real drive into that? And that gives you, so the problem size and the available resources and competence gives you a priority of what you are can do in a year. And you have to somehow limit yourself here. And as you move along, you can add more complex and other things in the later years. And that has been a crucial element of success. And of course, you don't end with defining specifications. You end with implemented software after 1 year. And that is also a goal. So you wish to develop, but then you wish to deploy. And there must be a customer. And there must be a business case. And if any of this is missing, you're going to lower your probability of success.
I fully agree with what Stefan is saying in the sense that for us in NSUE, one of the key factors of success is to have the standardization team, so the team that is doing the data format and interoperability, very much linked to the project, to the IT project that are delivering the project. And we saw that each time that we were doing standardization very much linked to some real IT project, so network code implementation in our case, it was a success. When we were doing standardization outside and not enough linked to it, it doesn't work. It's only working when we are very much linked to the project. This is the first factor of success. The second is to have the correct people around the table. If you in NSUE, we have an expert group that gave her all the experts from the TSO, of course, we are a TSO association, but from all the European TSO. And this enabled to have a structure where afterwards, a country cannot say, okay, no, I was not involved. I didn't say my word. I want something else. No, there is an expert group. Everyone can be there. And this is where you can get the consensus. It's really interoperability is really about consensus. If you have a consensus, then you have something that can be then recognized by everybody. You can have the best technical solution. If it doesn't make the consensus, it will not work. It's not possible. And then the third element of factor of success for me in NSUE, it was the link that we have with the standardization organization. Because here you have first, you don't reinvent the wheel, you take what is existing. And second, you have also a very clear process where the member state can, through their national committee, participate to the process and say, okay, this standard is good. This is not good because this, and send comments. And for us, it was a really major step in NSUE in the standardization and interoperability when in 2014, we decided to transfer our NSUE data format into the SIEM data format, to the IEC, so the International Standardization Organization data format, that is a link with CENELEC. CENELEC is a European one. They have agreement together, so it's a European norm somehow. So it was very important to transfer our data format to the IEC so that we can embark the industry more broadly. And we see it. So one of the example of this is when we look at the common grid model. So the grid model, we have now a standard that can be used everywhere in the world. And we see the Japanese that they want to use it. We see all the different countries that can use it. And this also lowers the cost a lot, because when you have the vendors that can go into different markets, it lowers the cost. But then just to summarize, three sectors of success: the link to the project, to have the correct people around the table, and the link to the standardization organization. That would be my three factor of success.
Thank you, Olivier. I think now it's time to maybe also turn to governance, right? Because you seem to be all quite nicely aligned on what to do, how ambitious to be. But now let's talk about governance, because if I look at the governance of each of your three initiatives, it's quite different. So, which, and Valerie in the paper also nicely discusses governance, saying, yeah, maybe there should be some central entity, but we didn't even want to dare to suggest who that entity could be. But I guess some of you might have some ideas on that. So how central do we need an entity, and what would that entity do, and who would be that entity? Who wants to come in on that one first? Stefan, please.
I mean, Valerie has shown the different layers of interoperability that we have, and it starts from the top in the legal and in the organizational domains. Mm-hmm. And we have a massive problem to link this layer with the technical layer down below. And there is, in fact, there are some links, but they are definitely not developed enough. We have the European Union, which is somehow giving us the politics and the strategy. And the lower layer must be structurally connected to that top layer. And that is a challenge. And we don't have a solution in Austria as well, and not in Europe. There is too much distance. And so if you do the work on the technical end and the profiling, as it has been described, you're still not sure that you are going to have a business case in the next 3, 4, 5 years. And I think it's nice if you discuss about the lower layers of the governance, but I think the crucial thing is that you must connect it to the strategy, to the legal, to the European level. And this must be, they should give us some timeline. And then I think we will find ways to organize the process below that, is my feeling.
You seem to touch also on the question of Eleonora, who says, is there not a contradiction between we must have a business plan beforehand, but at the same time, we need to discover and learn along the way. So are you saying, Stefan, that instead of a business case, it could be a higher level governance, regulatory compliance that forces you to do things?
Well, I mean, at least, like we mentioned, I mentioned the Corona thing. You have a number of cases per day. That's a very clear number. We have tons of CO2 that we are generating per day. And that is also a clear number. And I feel that the European Union and the planet wishes to reduce that number. Yeah. So, I mean, a very clear goal would be, let's measure that number on a daily basis and let's see that we reduce it. And that would be one element. And there are, of course, many others. And that is politics. So these goals must be a timeline. And there must be some, benefits if you comply and some punishment if you don't comply. And that is basically the top end of this. And then the rest, the lower layer, the other layers will align, is my feeling.
So that means that in energy, we do have an opportunity with these acts of, that are going to implement the articles that Valerie referred to, because we could put some of these targets and these KPIs in there, right? What do you think about that, Luis? Please. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Leonardo. I was thinking about this. I think this is the governance issue is a very important one. But we should not put a lot of cognitive effort on that. So we should make it simple. Let's see, the implementing act will be something feasible if we have the capacity to get consensus on the table and to have a clear dialogue between the parties. I think it is. We don't need, I think it was Olivier that mentioned that we don't need to reinvent the wheel. But not reinventing the wheel is not saying that we are not going to use this standard or the other one. It's about saying that we are going to use the best principles that we learn from the other industries. So we have the example here with us today. And I recently came across with I think it's from a health, also a project sponsored by the European Union, that establishes a list of priorities if you want to have interoperability between systems. And I'm quoting there, they say, first you should start by identifying the use cases. Then you should select the profiles. And I think it was Stefan that mentioned the profiles. Profiling is a very important topic because you start by defining the universal profile, then you come to the jurisdictional profiles, so something that has to do with the member states, and then you come to you go down and drilling down, and then you come to the application layer. That means that you start with one thing, and then we end with a subset of that thing, but that really works in reality, and that is a very important step forward. Then you also have to agree on the data content. And someone mentioned, I think it was Valerie, that vocabularies are very important. A common data language, it's very important, independently of the of every different systems, because it's not a secret. We can have different systems with different standards, with different data formats, then we have APIs, and then we have translators, whatever. And it's from a technical point of view, it's not so complicated. It's not reinventing the wheel to put systems communicating with each other, as long as we cope with existing standards, not the standards from the sector, but the neutral standards, the universal standards that are used nowadays for web services based APIs and things like that. So it's not a secret, it's there. And then we also need to write down these interoperability solutions and specifications, because we need guidelines and we need to do that. And finally, you need to organize testing. And who, I think you had also.
And who should run that, Luis? What kind of an entity
We are just two more points, because I think I add something to this list on my own, because I think it's also important. One, I think it's mentioned in your report, it's about monitoring the implementation. That is very, very important. It's not only defining the guidelines, it's also to control and see if everything is well implemented. But then you have to take into account that you should achieve the lowest implementation costs and the lowest life cycle costs. And that should be cross-domain and should be based, of course, on stakeholder dialogue. Mm-hmm. On your question, who should implement? I think we should have a fair discussion between all stakeholders to understand how to set up, I mean, of course, leading with this discussion should be led by the European Commission, how to set up such an entity, or if needed be, to set up an entity. But we need also to count on neutral parties that are more focused on making this connection that Stefan very well mentioned between the strategy, the use cases, and the technical implementation. I think entities like Joint Research Center are very well positioned to do a job like this one. I'm not referring here to SENS and ELEC. I think SENS and ELEC are very important because they know the standards, but I think this is too much technical when we enter into that field. I think the issue here is exactly to create, to make the bridge between the strategy, the processes, and the field operation. And for that to happen, we need someone that could look in a neutral way to the real implementation, in not pushing for the solution A or B, but acknowledging that we have different realities across Europe. And what we need to do is to define universal profiles, to bring those universal profiles to national profiles, and then the national profiles to implementation profiles. I think this is the way forward.
Thank you, Luis. Very clear. Olivier?
Yes, for us, in what I see from in Ensui is that in terms of organization, how it could work, I believe that we need to differentiate between the different interoperability targets. And when we are talking about a core process model, a process for all the countries, it might not be the same organizational structure than when you are talking about a common information model or a harmonized role model. So when you talk about a process, here you are a little bit more in the business layer, and it can involve parties that will look more into this angle. However, when you dig into, for example, the semantic and the information model, here it is for us it is obvious that SenseNelec has the best knowledge because it is semantic and it is a technical standard. And here for us they have really the best knowledge to lead this kind of discussion. Of course, it's only our opinion. It's what we see when we have been working with them for many years. So that's how I would see that. For the role model, we have today in NSUI a role model with EFET and EBIX. And what we are looking for the coming in the future is to embark more and more the DSO association to have something that is showing the European role model, but that is also including more stakeholders. Today we came to agreement with EFET and EBIX, and EBIX represent, it's a forum, so it's only a few countries, a few actors, but still it gives the view of the retail market, so it's already something. But we believe that it would be worth it to have more feedback from the retail market in this harmonized role model. We believe that it would make better, it would make it stronger and more, because today it's only EBIX and EFET and N3, and we think that it could be more more stakeholder into this role model.
Yeah, Jeremy, please.
Now, thank you. I think one of the things that needs to be considered is that when you talk about the expertise in SenseNelec, they have it, certainly. You look at the modeling that takes place in IEC with the Common Information Model, the SIM. There are a lot of pieces and parts from a lot of groups. And one of the things that might be considered, and Luis, maybe this is something that sort of picks up on what you were discussing, there is an opportunity to allow those who are experts in their field to add to it and then simply bring all those parts to the table. That's what we did with the green button. We used the SIM as a basis for the entire definition models. We also used ATOM, the RSS syndication feed format, as a way to turn the what would essentially be a flat file into a relational database so that you could pick and choose from a very large file for information. By looking at groups that already had solved pieces of the puzzle or could solve those pieces, we just simply acted as a center point to bring it all together. And there's plenty of opportunities in Europe to have that center point to bring it together and keep the activities in the groups that can assess those best and bring them to fruition best. There's of course Linux Foundation Energy, there's IEEE, there's the IEC itself, of course, or JTC1. There's a number of places in Europe that can do that sort of a thing. And then incorporate the local activities that are happening in the regions that might differentiate one region from another. In the United States to some extent in Canada, we have a very different market bifurcated by state level or even parts of state levels, where we might have certainly kilowatt hours or a kilowatt hour no matter where you are, but for gas, for example, sometimes it's in British thermal units that you would receive this. Other times it's in cubic meters. Other times it is in 100 cubic feet. There's a variety of different ways of representing it. And to unify one way for us was very difficult because we don't have those mandates that come from a European overhead. We do it all the way, whenever we feel like doing. We buy gasoline in gallons, but we drink our Coca-Cola in liters. So we're very difficult here, and so we've embraced that difficulty and simply decided we're not going to make everyone change, but rather we'll make the format carry whatever that local flavor is going to be. People are used to receiving things in liters. That's what they're going to receive it in. How many liters of water have you used? That's the way we do it. And that allows us to leave it to the locals as well as to the experts.
Sounds very familiar, Jeremy. Stefan.
Yeah, what I like here is I think we have a lot of common views on this, like what Louis told about the process. And basically, I see a lot of alignment with what Olivier said. And I agree that IEEE and IEC and Sensenelec have a competence. So I'm very happy that this is a common view. We have been discussing the business models and the business plans. And that is, I think, something that we need to put more work in. At least that's my feeling. To discuss what we mean by this, and that links the political layer, the higher layer with the lower engineering layer. And I think that is something I would like to discuss more in the future.
And probably also needed to get the consensus that both Louis and Olivier are talking about, right? That's the logic. If people understand the benefits, they will move. Huh? Valerie, are you happy? Did we discuss, your paper?
Our paper. Yes. I'm very happy. I think it was extremely interesting. Thank you all. Thank you all to the panelists. I take a couple of things from today, and I think it aligns with what Stefan and Jeremy said. I take away it's a big challenge and that we have to learn from each other, but also from our experience that we already have. I take away three buzzwords, which are community spirit, culture of data sharing, and consensus. I think we might want to apply really a use case driven approach. We might want to look for business cases and for interest that is there and not do something just for the sake of doing something. We might need a central place for all the efforts that have been done to align them. And indeed, there have been a lot of efforts that have already been done. And so we should probably make use of what we know already, what exists. And we should try not to scare somebody off with this big challenge, but rather get everybody around the table and make everybody see the benefits. And I think this leaves a lot of work for us at FSR, but also a lot of work for everybody who joined this webinar today, and especially also for all the panelists. So thank you again for joining, and also Leo, thank you a lot for moderating.
Thank you very much.
Thank you all. Ciao, ciao.
Thanks.
Bye.